afternoon. Martin already provided you with a little bit of background on what this session is going to be about. If you read the title, Advertising Marketplaces, Who Leads the Deal, it does leave it rather open-ended. But we've got a very illustrious panel that represents a specific space that is very fast-growing and very dynamic, essentially networks and real-time bidding and various players within that space. I'm going to, first of all, introduce and bring to stage all five of the speakers, but we will have an introductory and an opening comments from one of our speakers. But before I do that, I wanted to actually just give a little bit of a reminder that I think you've probably heard in the previous sessions that we do take questions from the audience, and if you do have a question, you can send it over Twitter at hashtag DeMexicoConf, and just please make sure once we do get into the panel portion that you do so. So I'll bring the five speakers to stage and then do a short introduction for Bob. If they can come to stage as I introduce them, Bob Carrigan, the CEO of IDG Communications. Michael Barrett, the CEO of AdMeld. Curt Hecht, from CEO of Vivaki Nerve Center. Esco from Microsoft. Esco Strong, excuse me, from Microsoft Exchange. And then Brian O'Kelly, the CEO of Appnexus. So you've had a long afternoon. Some of you are very comfortable in your chairs, possibly reading and sending emails. Let me ask you a question just to make sure you're all awake and listening. It's a lot of acronyms in this topic, and you'll probably end up, as I was, learning a substantial amount about this specific space during the course of the panel. But let me find out what you know now. Just as a simple show of hands, how many of you feel like you have a strong understanding of what real-time bidding means? Maybe about a quarter. How many of you feel like you have a very strong understanding of DSPs, of agency trading desks, of all the different acronyms that exist within real-time bidding? Show your hands again. Roughly about half of that. So that is a good indication that we should probably start the panel by at least explaining what everybody on this panel does. But before we do so, I do want to bring Bob up for some introductory remarks. Bob is, again, the CEO of IDG Communications, but he also serves as the current chairman of the IAB. He worked with AOL before going to IDG and brings a wealth of experience from publishing, marketing, and sales experience. If you could please all welcome Bob to the podium for his opening remarks. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. Am I on?
Yep.
Live? Okay, great. Thank you. Thank you, Michael. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great honor to be here today as part of this auspicious panel. And I don't use that word auspicious lightly. My company has the pleasure of doing business with all four of these distinguished citizens, and they are truly among the best and brightest in our industry. That's why I'm so delighted to have the chance to speak first today. With this group on stage, I know I'm probably not going to have the last word, but at least I'm guaranteed of having the first. So to get things started, I've been asked to lead off on this topic of the role of media companies in networks and exchanges, and to speak about this in the context of the overall title of our session, which asks the question, who leads the deal? Well, the answer to that question is simple. We do, the media companies, of course. We lead the deal. I am the introductory speaker. And what else would you expect me to say? No matter what these other people tell you, the media companies lead, period, end of story. So now that we've settled that and before my fellow panelists can jump on me, let's move on. But of course, I am only half kidding. The answer to who leads in the networks and exchange space is a complicated question. And I'm sure our panel will examine those complexities during this hour. But what I would like to do in my brief remarks is explore a relatively unique approach to the network and exchange question that up to now hasn't been widely adopted by my fellow media companies. The several media companies like mine that have adopted this approach, I'll discuss, have found it to be extremely helpful and beneficial, especially in a dynamic, interactive advertising market. So for purposes of illustration, and the sum total of my audio visual presentation, I will I give you this chart. Okay, so this is a chart of how we're organized at IDG in a world of online networks and exchanges. And let me say, I don't mean to make this presentation about my company, but since IDG has adopted this approach I'm advocating, I thought I'd illustrate it using my organizational chart. So IDG is, if you may not know us, is a 47-year-old media company that exclusively serves the technology media space. Our primary marketplace is a first-party publisher, where our content is generated by editors and runs across some 470 owned and operated sites around the world. The content is centered around some well-known brands like PC World, Mac World, Computer World, CIO, etc. We also have a bunch of offline properties, but that's for another conference, about 200 magazines and a bunch of events. But I'll just focus on online. So about 3 years ago, we launched another network, a third-party network, called the IDG Tech Network. And this network encompasses another 450 sites and growing, none of which is owned by IDG. Now, you may recall at the time of our launch that there was a lot of debate among media companies about the goodness or evil of ad networks, their future role in the industry, and whether it made sense to do business with them. And we took a different approach. We decided, if you can't beat them, compete with them. And so we reasoned that if a portion of our tech advertisers, our primary audience, wanted both first-party, targeted, owned and operated inventory, as well as audience-targeted, network-centered solutions, then that's what we would give them. And so we launched our own vertical ad network with audience targeting. And we've evolved it over 3 years into a robust sell-side platform with solutions including video and lead generation and marketing services and so on. And last month, we served about 1.2 billion impressions across this network. So our most recent solution to our sell-side platform launched 9 months ago was the Tech Media Exchange, or TMX as we call it. That's our own private vertical tech exchange. And from its early growth rates, we're really pleased. The revenue is ramping, and from what we see, there's great potential. And we believe at the end of the day, TMX will prove to be another successful venture. Now, as a result of our own entry into areas like ad networks and exchanges, we've developed a philosophical and business approach that more media companies might consider. It's an approach based on three simple precepts. Number one, if media companies want to continue to be leaders, then they have no choice but to respond to new customer desires. So it's well known that most so-called traditional media companies, by and large, have been somewhat reluctant to dip their toes into a part of the market that is digital and automated and therefore alien to their owned and operated properties. Although going through the expo here, I'm impressed by the number of German companies that have networks. I think a higher percentage of German media companies seem to have networks than in the US. But a lot of media companies say our companies have always dominated our audiences, and they expect wrongfully that they will continue to dominate those audiences. But the fact is that the orderly distribution of media that we once enjoyed is over. Today, we all deal with a highly fragmented market where venture capitalists put their bets, big ones, on smaller, nimbler firms whose mission is to displace traditional media companies. And to a great degree, these new firms are winning. In IDG's tech media marketplace, we perceived an opportunity that went beyond the business we were doing on our owned and operated websites. We saw value in organizing the category for our customers, a category that you might say was unfocused with too many acronyms and all these ad tech solutions. So we seized on the network opportunity and in our latest offering provide biddable solutions through RTB. So the question for media companies isn't whether exchange technology or RTB is helpful or whether these innovations will commoditize and ultimately ruin the ad business. The real question is, do our customers want this technology? And the clear answer to that question is, you bet they do. Number two, so therefore, since our clients clearly desire this interactive facility, media companies shouldn't concede the digital business to startups and upstarts. Here again, media companies are used to being historical leaders in their categories. Certainly, that is the case with IDG in the tech space, if I may say. But being a leader was a lot simpler in the days of analog media. In today's media, leadership means being willing to compete and emerging high-value segments of one's industry's niche. Many traditional media companies already wield tremendous influence in their vertical marketplaces, so they should approach these new digital challenges as new related opportunities, thinking and acting like a digital media company, rather than conceding huge growth segments to venture-backed newcomers. That's what we did. In the tech space, we saw the development of networks and exchanges as an emerging opportunity. And today, we're right there competing nose-to-nose with these players. The point is that I'd much rather be competing actively day-to-day than sitting on the sidelines grousing about the evils of networks and exchanges and how it'll lead to the demise of the ad business. As they say, be careful what you wish for. So finally, if you agree not to concede the business to others, that means, number three, that you've got to jump in, and I mean with both feet. And what we did was we structured an entire new division around this network and exchange concept. We created a separate online business with its own CEO, a dedicated sales staff, its own resources. The sole function of this dedicated organization is to sell audience-targeted solutions in the network and exchange space, period. That's it. So now the question that some people have raised is, aren't we competing with ourselves, in effect, cannibalizing our own products? The answer to that question is absolutely not. The advertising market is so big and growing that there's still a huge demand for scarce content-targeted inventory, such as what we're known for in the tech media space. And we continue to see fantastic growth on our premium owned and operated inventory, all of which is sold via our branded sales teams. So our operating philosophy, again, is that there are huge opportunities in both the exchange and premium owned and operated business space. So let's have at both of them. And if we experience an occasional overlap, it's a small price to pay for significant returns. So I'd like to quote the words of Lloyd George, the great British Prime Minister, who, as far as I know, is a man who never had any experience with ad exchanges, who once famously said, "The most dangerous thing in the world is leaping a chasm in two jumps." My question is, what are media companies waiting for? Jump in. At least that's what we've done. And as I turn this discussion over to my fellow panelists, who I suspect are now really chomping at the bit, let me return to the original question about who leads the deal. Well, as I said, I work with and respect greatly each of these panelists and companies. My firm uses their white label solutions, their technologies, inventory. We share ad dollars with them. I could conclude, therefore, that the role of these panelists is as part of my value chain, that my media company is the one that owns the deal and should be leading it. I could say that, but I won't, because that would be rude, and I am a guest here. So I'll leave it to this distinguished panel to decide. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much, Bob. So during the course of this panel, you're going to hear words like demand-side platforms, trading desks, ad exchanges, supply-side platforms, yield optimizers, trading, real-time bidding platforms. All of these things are reduced to acronyms. And if I can actually just ask for the two slides that I prepared to go up onto the screen. I apologize in advance. Most of you have probably seen this many times. And in fact, I'm sure this actually is out of date. To Luma, I apologize because I probably have a slightly out-of-date slide. There is a cynical British attitude that it may well simplify in time if you go to the next slide. And I suppose this could happen across all industries. Eventually, we'll be buying our cars, our houses, and everything else from Google. But lightness aside, and let's go back to the panel discussion, let's just say this is a complicated space, and it's easy to get confused. And you know, one would certainly hope that it won't simplify to the nth degree of Google. But in the spirit of providing the three quarters of you who didn't raise your hand a little bit earlier, what I'd like to do to start, Bob had his chance. Now I'm going to give equal time to the other four participants. And what I'd like to do just to start is ask them two things. First of all, to introduce themselves and provide a little bit of background on what their company does and how it plays within the real-time bidding kind of ecosystem. But also, I think everyone here would happily advocate that RTB is a fast-growing space that's only going to grow faster. And I'd like them to provide just some insight in terms of their own business and their clients as to why they think that's taking place. So starting out in order, if we go to Michael first. Michael, CEO of AdMeld.
Hi, I'm Michael Barrett, CEO of AdMeld. And AdMeld's a a New York-based ad technology company that works with global premium publishers to help them maximize their ad inventory, make the greatest amount of revenue. We started off with a relatively simple proposition, but trying to solve a big problem for advertisers, and that was traditionally unsold inventory that they couldn't sell direct to ad agencies or to advertisers. Primarily, ad networks would buy that inventory from them, and as their supply of inventory increased, they had to work with multiple ad networks. We saw an automated solution there. We created a platform and integrated those ad networks into the platform, put them in competition with each other on an impression basis to raise yield for our publishers who we work for. That space has since exploded in terms of complexity for publishers. There's DSPs, there's agency trading desks, et cetera. But from a publisher perspective, it's actually all good. More money is a good thing. More demand sources are a very good thing. RTB is leading a lot of the conversation as it relates to monetizing inventory for publishers. But it's important to note, it's just part of the overall portfolio that a publisher would want to put together. RTB is pays great rates. It's a very specified buying technique by agencies right now. And absent ad networks and other competitors, it wouldn't be as strong as it is today. So from our standpoint, RTB is a terrific addition to the overall puzzle for a publisher to increase yield, but it is not an end-all and be-all in a single point of solution.
Okay, can you hear?
Curt, go ahead.
Curt Hecht, I run the Vivaki Nerve Center, which is part of Publicis Group, and my team supports Zenith OptiMedia, Starcom MediaVest Group, Razorfish, Digitas. And we play two important roles within our company. One is my team faces off with Facebook, Google, and Microsoft, the platform companies, and represents Publicis Group with them. Not so much on buying the ads, but how we leverage their technology, how we make sense of it, and pull that through our client teams. The other aspect to it is, what are the market-facing technologies that we need to have to be most effective in addressable media? So search, display, increasingly the Facebook API. And to your question on RTB, I think we take a broader view of this, which is we know that clients want to take data into the media marketplace directly and leverage technology to do that, and they're going to do it across multiple screens and with multiple media partners, and we need to be best in class in helping them enable it.
Great. Esco.
I'm Esco Strong. I'm the Director of Marketplace Management for the Microsoft Advertising Exchange. And so Microsoft, in addition to having some small positions in productivity software and operating systems and search, we also have quite a diverse portfolio of display advertising assets, including Windows Phone 7, Xbox, MSN, Windows Live, an advertising network, the Microsoft Media Network, and the Atlas Ad Serving System. So we were very interested in the potential of RTB as another channel for selling our media, and something that we heard, quite frankly, from a lot of our clients as a promising new way for them to buy, where they could better value the inventory, they could better select the inventory that they really wanted to buy and not have to buy in bulk. And so we really feel like we've been a pioneer in terms of premium publishers with many assets to bear, bringing that inventory at scale into RTB and offering all of our discretionary inventory up on the Microsoft Advertising Exchange. So it's a pretty unique set of challenges for a large publisher with a direct sales force and brand sales, in addition to interests in the network space and other spaces to solve through some of the issues of channel conflict, channel management, and publisher yield. And so we think we've had an interesting experience there, and we've got some experiences certainly to share with other publishers of a similar scale.
Great. Brian?
Hi, Brian O'Kelly. I'm the CEO of Appnexus. We're the largest independent provider of real-time technology in the space. So our philosophy is that this is a really hard problem, as I think both Bob and Esco have alluded to. And so I think we're very fortunate to count both of those companies as our clients, along with Collective, Mexad, and about 200 other companies around the ecosystem. So our philosophy, if you look up at Terry Kawaja's slide we just saw, is to provide as much technology as possible to make the entire ecosystem work. So you could look at that as plumbing, or you could look at that as really good plumbing, but it's really our core specialty. And I just want to thank all of you for being here and also mention to you, this is one of the best panels I've ever seen. You've got really the visionaries of the space here, so I'm thrilled to be here.
Excellent. Okay, well, I want to start out with what we assume to be the case, but we haven't actually spoke specifically about it, in terms of the share that RTB is currently taking and how large of a slice of the market that we expect it to. And the numbers vary. There's estimates that are anywhere between 5 to 10%, upwards of 20% and more, depending on the time scale and, as Curt alluded to, what you include. And actually, I'd like to start with Curt because he's representing many of the buyers. What would you say is the current percentage in Europe versus the US of RTB, and where would you see it going?
We were playing around with the numbers before we got ready for this panel, and maybe it's 5 to 10% in the US based on the growth of the marketplace overall. I think if you look at where Google's gone in terms of just display dollars, a lot of that's obviously powered by YouTube and AdX, and so it's a good percentage in Europe. Part of the reason that I moved from the States to Paris was to actually focus on pushing the market, pushing our team so that we would see more growth. Our belief is that clients are going to want to be more precise with their dollars. It's a combination of building brands and sponsorships and all the idea-driven components of the business, which we actually think are alive and well, and Razorfish and Digitas do quite well at that, as well as our media shops. But once they build demand, we want to be able to convert using the addressable channels. So we know that percentage is growing, and the other part that we talked about earlier is we don't look at it as just RTB, right? So search is a fantastic addressable channel. It's big, display is coming along, and increasingly, believe it or not, we're already spending more time discussing how we're going to do things like buy through the Facebook API, which we're already doing today. So we just look at it as biddable media that's data-driven, and we know that it's a big and growing marketplace.
If you were to highlight the display element of it, though, and we talked about this before in terms of the adaptation that was first and direct response versus the larger brand spends, what would you say is holding people back from adopting it in a greater scale?
So from a client perspective, in the States, we have, I think, about 225 clients up and running through our platform. I think about a 95% renewal rate. What we found is that there's different dimensions to what those clients want. So, of course, you've got the performance-driven clients that want checking accounts to be opened, and they're measuring it in a very precise way. Other clients are saying, wow, if I can go through these automated channels and buy adults 18 to 49 for a dollar less at scale, that's very compelling, and others want context. And so I think what we found is that there's a lot of different dimensions, and really our biggest task is to stay away from the acronyms and simplify it, so that they understand that there's a lot of opportunity in the market. The more that we talk about technology, bring acronyms in, and really sound geeky, we actually see that it's much harder for us.
Esco, you sell across a lot of different channels. Where are you seeing this fit into your own kind of buying and selling ecosystem?
We've seen it as a different offering that's really complementary to a lot of our other offerings. So, again, customers have different needs, as Curt alluded to. There are different types of advertisers, different types of goals, and ultimately different means of achieving those goals. So we think that for a large segment of the customers, they're going to continue to buy on a branded basis where they really value context and location and a guaranteed delivery of impressions. For other folks that want to uniquely leverage our Microsoft advertising assets, some of that's data, or they want a little high level of service, they may buy through our network for audience or performance. And then for others who have, they want to manage, for example, their frequencies, their target frequencies across a number of buys, a number of marketplaces, folks that have sort of unique first-party buy-side assets to bear that they want to leverage without risking leakage, or folks that have unique algorithms, they're definitely going to go into RTB and take advantage of that. So we've really taken the approach of embracing this other channel. It's been very good for us. It's helped us. Simply put, exchanges in general terms, and RTB certainly being a part of that, is a very efficient means of allocating resources, matching buyers and sellers, and allowing the buyers to get that additional layer of transparency when they buy and looking at the cookie, looking at the user, allows them to really pick out the stuff that's very valuable to them. And obviously, as a publisher, we want to encourage that as well, and it's helped our business, it's helped our bottom lines as well.
Bob, are you seeing similar things?
Yeah, I mean, today RTB is 10 to 15% of our business. It's a channel in our network, and for those clients that want biddable solutions, we want to offer that. And we have been able to move business in that direction because, again, we're a vertical network. We're dealing with sites that presumably we have domain expertise about, technology-oriented sites. We bring them in, vet them, make sure that they are brand safe, so to speak, on an individual basis, and then some of those make it to our exchange. And so we found that when we do that and we offer that to exclusive clients, that creates a great opportunity to move some of that inventory at premium prices, frankly.
You said brand safety, and that's a good segue to the topic. And I'll just throw it maybe to Brian on the end to start as the kind of technology provider. Where do you see your solutions kind of assisting people to ensure some comfort and some safety in terms of brand safety?
Well, there's really two parts to that question. One is for a brand buyer to make sure that they're running on inventory that's high quality. And so, we actually have a human auditing team that looks at every site we work with, whether it's directly in one of our partners or through our platform. We also work with technology partners. There's a bunch of really interesting contextual and verification companies out there that will analyze the inventory in real time. One of the things that we do that's unique is that before we actually send an ad off for real-time bidding, we actually can ask all of these partners, hey, Double Verify, is this okay? Hey, Pier 39, hey, Proximic, hey, whoever. We can find out, and before we actually run an ad, we know what our partners think. On the opposite side, our major publishers like Microsoft have very specific rules. I think Microsoft has an 83-page creative approval policy. which we enforce to the letter, and it's different in every country. So we launched 7 new countries now or something around Europe, yep. And they all have different needs. They all speak different languages, but there's different rules and things we have to enforce. So one unique thing about our platform and our partnership with Microsoft is that before we run any creative, we actually have a human being looking at it who speaks the right language and who can say, well, this violates the policy or it passes. And the really simple way to think about this is, if you see an ad with an iPhone in it, then it better click through to an Apple site. If it doesn't, it's probably not an Apple ad. And so our team knows how to check for that. And actually, that gets rid of most of the really crappy ads. If it clicks through anywhere else, it's probably some kind of poor ad. And there's a lot more rules we check for all kinds of malware and fraud and viruses and things like that. But that's really the only way to technologically solve these problems. That said, a lot of these business rules come from our partners. So Bob and IDG have very different business rules than Microsoft to protect their advertisers. So it's critical if you're a publisher and you know you've got a bunch of really high quality endemic technology advertisers like Bob does, he really doesn't necessarily want us to run a bunch of Apple ads because his sales team is very, very good at selling to Apple. So we can set rules or price floors or other things. And we could talk about private exchanges, which actually tie to brand safety, because if you don't know what brand is running, in the example we're giving Apple, how can I enforce my business rules about what can or can't run?
I would say from a marketer agency perspective, we have 3 layers of verification. So one is the automated third-party Double Verify, who ranks, I think on a quarterly basis, they'll come out and they'll say, here's how everybody's doing in terms of using Double Verify, knowing where their ads run, et cetera, et cetera. The second piece to this is within our what we call audience on demand, which is our team that's buying this addressable media, we have something called Vivaki Verified, where those teams will go through at a URL level and make sure they know where our clients' ads are going to run. And then the last level of verification is probably the toughest, which is the client teams. And having worked on a lot of big clients directly, client teams don't like it when they have to share bad news with their clients. And so once we get through those first two layers, the client teams are our client to make sure that when they go and see our big brand marketers that we don't have any ads running where they don't want those ads to run. And so, you know, kind of going back to the numbers and having 95% renewal rate from the client teams, what we found is our toughest critics are internal, which we think is great because our clients, in terms of the fee side of the business, that's a huge part of our business and we don't want to mess that up in the automated marketplace. So we're pretty well protected.
Well, there's a lot of issues and brands deciding whether or not to participate with RTB, but there's also a number of advisories and agencies and supporting companies that help them to make those decisions who have substantial resources and substantial technology. Possibly not so much on the publisher side, and actually I'd just like to kind of come to the other side of the pendulum with Michael. What would you say is the biggest issue for publishers that is holding them back from participating in RTB at the moment? When you're talking to publishers to potentially take advantage of the platform, what's the biggest objective or what's the biggest reason they give for not doing so?
Yeah, so that's probably a question that was pretty germane 12 months ago.
Right.
But the adoption today, we work with over 700 publishers worldwide, and every publisher that's in an RTB market is enabled for RTB and working with RTB.
Right.
So what were those objections and how did that come to pass? The first one is, and it's a horrible term because it's so widely misconstrued, but data leakage is certainly something that a publisher would say, but my data is going to permeate all over the internet, people are going to create profiles of my users, I'm never going to get compensated for it.
Right.
The second one was, man, that agency is buying directly from me. I call on that agency. I'm going to expose a different price to that agency than when I call direct. How do I mitigate that channel conflict? And so all of these are, some of them are unfounded concerns that can easily be talked to. Some are technical implementations that you can make to mitigate channel conflict. But by and large, you know, from a data leakage standpoint, from a publisher perspective, there's really no data that's passing at all right now. I think it's a huge opportunity for publishers going forward, passing valuable first-party data on their terms with the correct compensation involved. But right now, there's not a tremendous amount of that going on. So then the concern is, my user in that context of my site, a buyer can create profiles on an individual and buy. Well, buyers aren't prohibited to do that. Sometimes it's contractual, sometimes it's technology-based. But the fact of the matter is, we play a big role in working with white hats like the Appnexus of the world and other DSPs in making sure that the buyers, Vivaki, who are buying from us, abide by the rules and protect the publishers because they understand that without healthy, high-quality, branded premium inventory, the business isn't going to take off and go to where it needs to get to. And then lastly, you can go all the way to creating your own private exchange if you want complete and utter control, transparency, provisioning who buys what at what price, et cetera.
Great. And on that subject, Bob, do you feel like you've gone through this process now? Do you feel like the objections you had in the early days are now to the side? And more importantly, what new opportunities have you found through the use of RTB platforms that maybe you didn't expect?
Well, you know, as I said in my opening remarks, you know, we've been in the network space now for 3.5 years or so, and so we've been doing business with a lot of third-party companies and bringing lots of new solutions to them, and just, you know, listening to customers. Obviously, RTB has become a requirement, I think, for networks, and so, you know, we didn't have, I don't want to make it sound like we're some special company, but we didn't have sort of that issue with whether or not this is going to commoditize our inventory, et cetera. We certainly approach the market with very high-touch salespeople that sell very custom programs across top brands, and that's a big part of our business. But then there's this whole other part of the business that I think media companies should be much more immersed in. And frankly, it's almost bigger than however you measure it, the different ways to quantify it. But you know, there's a much larger pool of ad dollars against you know, in our categories that goes against the exchange and network business. And so, you know, for us, it was a business decision to, you know, step aggressively in that direction. And we haven't found any of our major agency customers saying, oh, well, I can buy, you know, inventory here and then, you know, it's it's priced differently there. First of all, we're bringing a lot of third-party inventory, and we are, again, selling audience-based, not brand-based, on the network side. And then on the network, on the owned and operated businesses, we're selling by brand and, you know, more traditionally. So, again, you know, it's just an operating philosophy. So those, I think for media companies, you know, the idea of selling on an exchange and in a way getting away from pure brand selling, you know, runs against the grain of everything we grew up in, if you're from that part of the business. But it's a huge and growing business, and there's plenty of room to compete on both the O&O first party side and the third party side, and now with RTB.
Well, in my prep for this, I had a number of people say that potentially the word remnant is actually a redundant term. Remnant is essentially what drives the network business, but you know, the idea that you're selling audience as opposed to inventory makes it potentially possible to create a whole new dimension to the buying and selling kind of ecosystem, if you will. And Curt said it in the pre-discussion. I'd like to just pick up on that again. You're buying audience. What are the kind of primary drivers that you are buying against? And obviously, it changes.
I mean, beauty's in the eye of the beholder on these things, right? So clients know what performance looks like to them, and you know that performance could be cost per thousand, it could be context, it could be acquisition, and they want to know where their ads run. There's no question about that. So they'll give us filters around, you know, what's acceptable from an inventory perspective, and then how that inventory ultimately performs is up to them, which I actually think is a good thing for marketers, once again, because they can determine value in that inventory uniquely to them. And I think what's happened in media for a long time is you have brilliant strategists coming up with unique consumer insights, which then get translated into demographics when they go and buy media in the analog space. And what we're really doing is finding an opportunity to take the great insights and be more precise in terms of applying those audience definitions to media. And that means different things to different clients. So I think because of that, more and more marketers are going to understand that this is a much bigger opportunity to say, how are we working with Experian? How are we working with Acxiom? Can we take a lot of the great work that we've done with data and now more actively bring it into media, which is a great opportunity.
Yeah, and from a publisher standpoint, it does kind of change the whole way you thought about inventory before, because you could sell it direct at the highest possible price, then it fell to remnant, and then you'd have tiered strategies for your unsold inventory. But if a buyer is looking for a specific segment, audience segment, a person that wants to take a flight from Cologne to Paris in the next 24 hours, that person's of high value. They'll pay a very high price for them. You wouldn't consider selling that ad direct because you're selling the individual now, not a page, not an ad unit. And so I think from an audience strategy standpoint for publishers, it's entering into a whole new phase that brings with it complexities, but huge opportunities if you start to organize your inventory correctly with audience being at the tip, as opposed to then sifting through unsold inventory trying to find valuable users. You should find them from the very first ad call.
And how difficult, Michael, just following on that, maybe leading the question slightly impossible, would it be for a single publisher to do that on their own versus participating in a platform?
They could definitely do it on their own, and you know, Curt has done direct deals with publishers and plugged into the ad server. But you know, most publishers, by and large, even the largest, most sophisticated publishers, have a finite amount of technology resources. And making the decision as to what data partner to plug into your ad server, how to arrange it, if they don't work, who do you bring in, what coverage of your audience are you going to get from them, those are terribly difficult to do. So working with platform companies that do integration for a living, like an AdMeld, an Appnexus, et cetera, it was a leading question. You're right. You should work with AdMeld.
Equal time to Brian on the end. From a technological perspective, on a scale of 1 to 10, how prepared or how well do you find publishers, or I should say customers, are to utilize the technologies that you provide? Do you find that, generally speaking, they have the skill sets and the internal resources to manage, or are you finding that you're spending a lot of time providing training and backup?
Well, that's not really a fair question with Esco standing next to me.
Okay, fair enough.
Careful, Brian.
Exactly. You know, it's been great, actually. I think that we've talked a bit about networks here, and we announced yesterday that High Media, which is the biggest ad network in Europe, has decided to migrate their business to the Appnexus platform. I think that's a big moment for Europe and for the exchange world, because we now have a European exchange really built around some of the complexities of working in this market. And that's both a validation of real-time bidding, but also an indication that some of these very large premium publisher-based networks are ready to make this transition. And Bob talked about it earlier. You know, Microsoft has been a great example as well. When we started this process with Microsoft last October, I think everyone in the industry was a bit skeptical that we could bring over all of their inventory in a timely fashion. In fact, I think we're at least 3 months, maybe more like 6 months ahead of schedule of migrating a bunch of inventory over, which is a huge testament to Microsoft. But also I think it says a lot about how easy this really is at some level. So you asked me for a scale of 1 to 10. I'd say that it's about an 8 right now. And Michael, you made the point that a year ago we saw lots of objections. What we're seeing now is that, in fact, at Appnexus, we're getting more phone calls of people wanting to use the platform than we can actually handle. And I think that's actually the shift now. We've hit a tipping point. Agencies are on board. Vivaki has been a great leader here. And now it's time, really, for us to figure out the next stage of how to actually drive more and more dollars into the channel. So we're no longer pushing. We're actually putting the brakes on a little bit.
And Esco, do you feel like the resources that you've, and again, possibly an unfair question standing beside your provider, and it was said beforehand that I think everyone on this stage is a vendor of one another in some way, shape, or form. Do you feel like the resources you've been provided actually help drive proving your audience far more efficiently than before? Is there a dramatic difference, or is it literally just another tool in the chest?
You know, I'd say we had a unique set of considerations, again, given sort of our footprint in the space, and we had a lot of requirements, some of which were not uncovered until we actually began the migration. So you can imagine from a publisher yield perspective, thinking through things like channel conflict and pricing, and you know, really your objective here is to sort of proliferate demand and expose as much of the surface area of your inventory as you can to as much demand out there. And so that requires really sort of a custom set of rules, a custom set of implementations to take into account all of those concerns. And so we found, you know, partnering with Appnexus, we were able to do so very quickly really sort of a trailblazing way, we felt, in terms of managing those considerations for a premium publisher with a lot of different things to think about. So absolutely, it's been a tremendously valuable relationship for us. It's one where we feel like we've learned a lot, and we've hopefully helped to push this industry forward a little bit collectively with all the other folks on the panel here. You know, RTB is really a fairly new thing, and we're breaking new ground, and it feels like it's been a really good set of progress in the last year, and so the next year is only going to be better.
Bob, if you were in a room with a bunch of other networks, what humble advice would you provide them to continue to compete, evolve, and either create partnerships or whatever is necessary to continue to thrive?
Well, first of all, they should stay out of the tech media space, because that's our space.
Okay.
It's not a good idea for them to compete. No. Look, I think there's a big opportunity in vertical segments, you know, we saw the proliferation of horizontal networks, and I think there's lots of opportunity to drill down into categories that lend themselves very well to creating, say, private exchanges, where you can bring highly focused buyers, highly focused inventory together with very modern technology and create new ways of selling inventory at premium prices. Yeah, I think there's a big opportunity in the vertical space, except for the tech space, which...
Can I weigh in on that one, too?
Yep, sure, Brian.
You know, Appnexus has a bunch of clients around the world that are ad networks, and so we get asked this question a whole lot. Actually, Eric Papero wrote a great blog post, hi, Ari, on let 1,000 ad networks bloom. I don't think there's 1,000 verticals, so we need more ways to differentiate. And, you know, Curt, you said, we'll work with networks as long as they bring a differentiated value proposition.
Yeah, that's
right. I'd love to hear more about that.
Yeah, so I mean, our view is that as marketers put more dollars into the marketplace, historically what they've done is they've driven consolidation. So if you're a multi-brand company, you don't necessarily have six different media agencies buying your television trying to buy the same primetime spot. Why? Because it inflates the price. We've seen that happen in publishing. We saw that happen in search. It didn't make sense to have five SEMs go after the same keyword because it inflated the price. And now what we're seeing is our largest marketers, as they put more money in the channel, what they're starting to do is look around and say, how many buyers are we asking to buy the same audience? Because if we have multiple buyers going after that same audience, it inflates the price. And so that will move along to likes, and that'll move along to the next thing that moves into the marketplace. And you know, clients are smart, procurement departments are smart, and we expect that as more dollars move in, we'll see consolidation if you're not really adding value. And that's what it's gonna be about. So do you have unique technology? Do you have unique inventory? Do you have unique data sets? Do you have the client's interests top of mind and at heart? And if you can answer those questions, I think you're gonna have a growing business. If you're not unique, I think that you will not be around for very long.
Esco, 1,000 different networks or further specialization or consolidation?
You know, I think to Curt's point, it's a combination of both, right? It's the extent to which folks can actually rely on differentiated assets rather than simple arbitrage. You know, given some of the new transparency, some of the new methods of buying out there, the folks that don't bring a very different proposition to the table, in fact, it's sort of coined this new term beyond just the ad network, there's the value-added network. You know, those are the folks that are going to thrive, and if there's 1,000 of them and they're able to actually build out their segments and you know, carve out their niche area, that's great. If not, there's definitely going to be consolidation. It's, you know, part of this effort here is, I think a lot of folks recognize in order to bring, you know, those offline dollars online eventually, we've got to get more efficient, we've got to drive some of the costs down, as Curt was speaking to, and that's going to naturally lend to some consolidation in a lot of different areas.
Okay. Yeah, we should highlight a couple of things that we're seeing in the European market specifically. So there's a couple of companies here in Europe that we've seen really take a step forward. I think the U.S. has been driving, but I'd like to highlight, for instance, here in Germany, Mexad has done some really interesting things. Sasha and Guido have done a really good job of driving some of the real-time bidding. In France, we've seen Matiro really as a leader building out some of these functionalities first in the market. In the UK, we saw infectious media. So we're seeing a lot of these. I don't even think it's fair to call them ad networks anymore. I think I coined a term, the ad trading specialist, the ATS. And I think we have to stop thinking of networks because there's some pejorative arbitrage in there. And let's separate out arbitrage from value creation. And I think that's really what we're seeing is. And I think we'll see a lot more of those across Europe and across the world of folks who really bring a lot of value into the agency or direct to client or just in terms of being able to aggregate and integrate all of that data and expertise together in one place.
Michael, can you elaborate just a bit more on private exchanges? We touched on it a couple of times, but I'd love to hear your thoughts a bit more on the space.
Yeah, so I mean, some of the largest branded publishers, publishers like CBS, NBC, in the States, the Weather Channel, large global cable operation. They were actually moving in a different direction. So we're creating platforms, a number of companies were in integrating buyers, and they actually started to move back and said, wow, you're making it almost too easy for people to get a hold of my media. You know what, I'm just gonna take a knee and I'm not gonna participate. And it got us to really having deep discussions with them as to what their concerns were and how we could almost mitigate all of it. But ultimately, it came down to control, period. And I'm not talking about control on a computer screen. Ultimately, the feeling that that inventory is your inventory, you've created it, it's high-cost inventory, you don't want to share that inventory and have it bump up against other inventory that isn't of equal value that may drag down the pricing of it. So therefore, if someone could come in and help me solve it, create a platform for just my inventory, and I can go to the buyers and provision which buyers at what price, and sometimes I want a $3 bid to beat a $4 bid because I have a deep relationship with that client and they did a direct deal through the sponsorship team, having all that control got them over the fence to say, okay, I know there's a lot of money in this exchange-traded space and this programmatic buying. Now I feel comfortable enough with the proper tools to go and run it myself. And so I think I know there's all certain different flavors of private exchanges, but to us, essentially, for a media company, it is owning their own platform, and we're just the technologists that build that platform for them.
Fantastic. Well, you've now had a 55-minute tour from the gurus of the industry, and if you haven't learned a lot, you were spending too much time emailing, because we have some fantastic knowledge on stage, and I learned a lot. I hope you did, too. We're going to move on to the next panel and let our distinguished panel leave the stage, but please give your thanks by a round of applause.